Hello friends, welcome to our new initiative Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be analyzing the news articles from Hindu, PIB, LiveMint and Indian Express for the day 28 October 2018. The relevant articles we'll be discussing today are these four for the prelims, and we'll also be seeing these two topics from the perspective of mains. The first article we'll be seeing today is the Prime Minister chairs 6th meeting of NDMA. This article was taken from PIB. So for prelims, one has to know what is NDMA, when was it constituted, and also what are its functions. So let's look at them now. So National Disaster Management Authority is a nodal agency which is functioning under Ministry of Home Affairs. So what is the purpose of constituting this National Disaster Management Authority? So its main mandate is to coordinate activities with respect to various disasters occurring in different parts of the country. Its primary purpose is to coordinate response to both natural as well as man-made disasters, and also to build capacity building to build in disaster resiliency and crisis response. So NDMA was constituted under Disaster Management Act, which was enacted in the year 2005. So this act also established state disaster management authorities with respect to all the states in our country. And one of the important functions of National Disaster Management Authority is to coordinate with these state disaster management authorities so that there is a holistic approach in order to deal with a crisis situation with respect to a particular state. The Prime Minister of our country is ex officio chairman of this body, and this body also consists of 9 members. So in order to ensure there is enough expertise to deal with a crisis situation, the 9 members of the board are chosen from different fields to face a crisis situation. So the members, they come from different areas including planning, infrastructure management, communication, metrology and also natural sciences. So to put together the expertise of all these 5 areas will lead to effective disaster management plan to cope up with a crisis situation. So this National Disaster Management Authority is divided into various divisions in order to ensure that there is efficiency in its performance. So the first important division of the body is policy and planning. So the mandate of this division is to make and update policy and plans with respect to different disasters, taking into consideration the regional differences existing in our country. And the second division is with respect to mitigation. And the third one deals with operation and communicational parts. The two other divisions include the division to take care of the administration in case of disasters, and also to improve the capacity building with respect to the center as well as with respect to the states. So the act, the 2005 act, also constituted National Disaster Response Force. So this National Disaster Response Force is a specialized force in order to cope up with the natural and man-made disasters in various parts of the country. However, this National Disaster Response Force, we do not have any separate recruitment for this force. However, the sources for this force, they come from other paramilitary forces such as CISF, BSF, ITPB and SSB. So currently, this National Disaster Response Force, it has 12 battalions, 3 each from Border Security Force and Central Reserve Police Force, and 2 each from Central Industrial Security Force, Indo-Tibetan Border Force and Sashastra Seema Bal. And this map shows the 12 battalions existing in different parts of India. So a second article we'll be seeing is Arunachal Assam on alert after barrier breaches. So this article was taken from the newspaper Hindu. So in News Wars, there was a report from China to the Central Water Commission of India stating that the barriers formed along Zhangpo upstream river was breached because of a landslide there. So this situation led to discharge of water at a speed of 18,000 cubic meters per second, which in turn may lead to a disaster situation in the downstream states of Assam and Arunachal Pradesh in India. So in order to mitigate such a scenario, the states of Arunachal Pradesh and Assam, they have pooled in the resources from National Disaster Response Force and State Disaster Response Force teams in those districts along the rivers Siang and Brahmaputra. So for the prelims, one has to understand the geography of the area. So here, and one also needs to know about the rivers, their tributaries and the direction of their flow. So the Brahmaputra River is called as Yarlung Zhangpo or Zhangpo River in Tibet area. So it takes a southern bend and flows into India as Brahmaputra. And there are many tributaries to River Brahmaputra in India, which one has to know, both the right-wing tributaries as well as the left-wing tributaries. For example, some of them are Lohit, Subansri, Surma, etc. So here are a few facts with respect to the River Brahmaputra. So the River Brahmaputra originates in Kailash Range in a glacier called as Shemyungdung Glacier. So this glacier, it occurs at an elevation of about 5,000 meter from the ground level, and the source is very close to the sources of river Indus as well as Satluj. So there's also an important pass located in this area, which is called as Mariam Pass. So, and this Mariam Pass separates the sources of Brahmaputra from the Manasarovar Lake, which is the place of origin of River Indus. So this river Brahmaputra, it flows through Tibet as Zhangpo River, and at the end of its journey, it abruptly takes a southward turn in a place called as Namcha Barwa. So this southward turn is called as syntaxial bend. And some of the main streams emerging out of river Brahmaputra from the north include Subanshri, Kaming, Danshri, Riyadik and Teesta. So this eastern ranges of Himalayas is a place which is very rich in biodiversity. And for the prelims, the UPSC asks the IUCN status. So IUCN status of different animals from different areas in our country. And as this area is rich in biodiversity, so one has to know about the different species which are present in this area. So let's see about some of the species along the course of Brahmaputra River. So first species is black-necked crane and the second is wild yak. Both of these come under vulnerable category of IUCN's red list. Now another species along the course of the river is Chiru, which is near Tretin. So several other animals like Bengal tiger, gangetic dolphin, golden mashir, white-winged wood duck, they come under endangered category of this IUCN list. There are also few other critically endangered animals along these coasts. For example, spoon-billed sandpiper, pygmy hawk and white-bellied heron, they come under critically endangered category which needs significant attention in order to protect them. Other animals like one-horned rhinoceros come under vulnerable category of IUCN, and Assam roof turtle, it also comes under endangered category. The next article we'll be seeing is IFC launches masala bond with denomination of $1 billion. So this article was taken from the New Indian Express. So what is IFC? So this IFC is an International Finance Corporation, which is a member under the World Bank Group. So one of the major functions of IFC is to provide credit support to corporate and the business entities via raising funds. And this IFC has now launched $1 billion masala bond in order to support the investment activities in our country. So one has to know what are masala bonds for the prelims. So these masala bonds are financial debt instruments, and these are debt securities which are Indian rupee denominated. So these bonds are basically used by the Indian entities in order to raise money from the overseas investors. So masala bonds in a word are in rupee denominated bonds issued to overseas buyers. So what are the uses of this masala bonds? So masala bonds has been bought in mainly to mitigate the currency risk. Here under masala bond, the currency risk is borne by the investor rather than the person who gets the money. For example, if the rupee depreciates during the repayment, that risk is borne by the investor, and according to RBI, this will realize notional savings. The next article we'll be seeing is RBI against independent body. This article was also taken from Indian Express. So there was an inter-ministerial panel headed by Economic Affairs Secretary S.C. Garg, which suggested for establishment of a new body called as PRB, that is Payment Regulatory Board. So according to the Interministerial Committee, it vouched for creation of Payment Regulatory Board as an independent regulator. So by creating it as an independent regulator, it will foster competition, increase the consumer protection, increase the systemic stability as well as the resilience in the payment sector according to them. However, this view is opposed by the RBI sources as it will take away the independent rights of the RBI as an institution. So the creation of PRB as an independent body will dilute the functions of RBI as an independent body, which is against the mandate for which RBI was created as a central bank of India. So one also needs to know about the objectives of setting up a payment regulatory board. As we all know, India is experiencing digital revolution, and because of the digital revolution, the consumers are increasingly using different payment gateways. However, there is no proper authority to take care of the issues relating to the different payment gateways, because of which the consumers may lose confidence about using these payment systems. So this calls for setting up of a new independent authority, that is Payment Regulatory Board, in order to take care of these functions. So this objectives of PRB are threefold. Number one is increasing the consumer protection, that is to increase the trust as well as the safety of the consumers who are using different payment gateways. And number two is increasing the stability and the resilience, that is making these payment system more efficient as well as stable, so that there is no loss for the consumers using these different payment gateways. And third function is to increase competition and innovation. Competition is very much essential to increase efficiency in the market economy, and this competition will definitely result in the interest of consumers, and which in turn will promote the ease of use and improvement in quality of the service provided by different payment gateways. The next article we'll be seeing is Azad Hind Government. This article was taken from PIB. So Azad Hind Government, or Provincial Indian Government, was a government established under the leadership of Subhash Chandra Bose in the year 1943. It was established in the state of Singapore and not India. So why did Subhash Chandra Bose had to go to Singapore to establish a new provincial government rather than being in India? So if you see the timeline, in the year 1943, Quit India movement was happening in India, and because of the heavy retaliation showed by the Britishers to the Indian leaders who were participated in Quit India movement, many of them were sent to prisons, and there was leadership crisis existing in India. So Subhash Chandra Bose decided to utilize this situation by forming a provisional government of India in Singapore in order to overthrow the British by fighting along with the Japanese forces and the prisoners of war captured by the Japanese forces from India. This Azad Hind government also had its own currency, which was issued during 1940s. And according to Netaji's declaration for this Azad government, every Indian citizen will be guaranteed religious liberty as well as equal rights and opportunities via this establishment. Three of the INA officers, Nawaz Khan, Sehgal and Dillian, they were branded as traitors. They were put into trials after the completion of World War II by the British government. And this INA trials, it saw widespread support across different places of India, and it acted as one of the triggering points for Britishers to leave India. The existence of this Azad Hind government, or the provincial government of India, it gave greater legitimacy to independence struggle against the British. Thus, the Indian National Army, it played a very important role in the last phase of India's freedom struggle, and thus it helped India gain Indian independence. So next article we'll be seeing is RBI opens banking tap to ease liquidity crunch for non-banking financial companies. So this article was taken from newspaper Mint. So here the news is RBI, that is Central Bank of India, has incentivized the bank to lend to non-banking financial companies by easing the liquidity norms. So by easing the liquidity norms, it provides a situation of liquidity relaxation, thereby banks can lend more to the non-banking financial institutions. So according to the recent trends, the non-banking financial companies and the housing financial companies, they contribute to about 25-35% of the incremental overall credit. And these non-banking financial companies, they in turn raise money from the banks and the mutual funds. However, the current scenario, due to sudden outflow of funds, especially from the mutual fund area, the non-banking financial companies are seeing a cash crunch. And in order to avoid this cash crunch, RBI eased the liquidity scenario so that the banks can lend more to non-banking financial institutions. So because of the credit crunch, the overall contribution of the non-banking financial institution, so this lack of liquidity has affected the credit growth of the non-banking financial institution, which has become less than 10% recently. Currently, RBI uses SLR, statutory liquidity ratio, as one of the important tools to control the liquidity in the economy. And according to RBI's recent mandate, this SLR stands at 19.5%. So the banks can have SLR in mainly three formats. Number one is gold, number two is cash, and number three is via government securities. However, currently various banks of our country, they hold government securities for more than 29% of its value, which is very much higher than the RBI mandated 19.5%, which in turn affects the liquidity into the economy. So in order to avoid this mismatch, the RBI has brought in this new regulation. So by following this new regulation of RBI, the different banks will be able to ease up to 59,000 crores, which in turn they'll lend to non-banking financial institution, and which in turn will help the health of Indian economy. Another change brought in by RBI is, earlier banks were allowed to lend only up to 10% of their capital to a single non-banking financial company. However, now this limit has been increased up to 15% of their capital for non-banking financial companies who are not into infrastructure lending. However, there are also other concerns with this move of RBI. According to many economic experts, the banks does not have any push to lend more, and this will be only a short-term measure and will not have any important manifestation in long-term scenario. So the final article we'll be seeing is Urjit Patel cited lower inflation to hold rates. This article was also taken from the newspaper Mint. So the Monetary Policy Committee, headed by RBI Governor, they maintained the repo rate without any change. And according to the committee, the inflation projection is under check. This is because, according to committee, the inflation will remain low in spite of other factors like high oil prices, volatile global financial markets, intensifying trade wars, as well as growing uncertainty in domestic financial landscape. So for the prelims, one also needs to know what is Monetary Policy Committee. So this Monetary Policy Committee is a committee of the Central Bank of India. So it is headed by the Governor of Reserve Bank of India. And the major function of this Monetary Policy Committee is to fix the benchmark policy interest rate, that is repo rate, which will in turn control the liquidity and inflation within the specific target level as mandated. Okay, this Monetary Policy Committee is a 6-member committee, and 3 members, they come from RBI. And three other members are appointed by the center. The 3 members from the RBI include the governor, the deputy governor, and one other officer from central bank. And the 3 members who come from the center, they are appointed from search cum selection committee headed by the cabinet secretary. The committee will meet 4 times a year, and it takes important decision it publicizes the important decision taken after each meeting. So it has been decided by the Monetary Policy Committee, taking into different situations, that the inflations must be maintained at 4% in order to sustain economic growth. However, taking into consideration different economic situations, a cushion of about plus or minus 2% is also provided. If the inflation breaches this limit, the Monetary Policy Committee must give a detailed survey of the reasons of the breach to the center. Thank you.